Okay, so agenda of this talk is to talk about what are the ML applications at Helpshift, and then architectures of ML components, what the challenges we faced while building this platform, and how you can build your own platform at your company using Python, and then at the end, lessons. Okay, so to give you just an idea at what scale Helpshift is, Helpshift Engineer is working, we are nearly installed on 1 billion devices across the world. 6.7 million conversations happens every month, 135,000 requests per second, 50 milliseconds response time. We have around 400 GB data transfer every hour. And at the peak, nearly 1,000 virtual machines are running just to support backend system. And whole this platform is on AWS plus Azure as well. Yeah. So before I start, I want to know how many of you are aware about machine learning or are working with building machine learning applications. Okay. Okay. Quite a large number. So this will be a very excited talk for me as well. Okay. So classical programming is like you define a rule and you give a data and you get answers. But machine learning is different. You give a data, you give answers, and the rules will be embedded in a model, and you will use that model to real-time predictions. So this is some different type of software development programming skills. So you need to develop platform and services according to it. Anyway, why machine learning? Why do we care about it? Yes, we care about it because we want to build more intelligent applications. So more intelligent applications that day-to-day we use is like Gmail. So Gmail is fully powered by, plus maps are fully powered by the machine learning only. So we want to build, or you also want to build the applications that are powered by fully machine learning. OK, so what are the main applications that we have at Helpshift? So one of the application is support ticket classification, end user files issue, and agents gets those issues. So user ticket text is, hey, I'm looking for bag. What would be the final price of this bag, leather bag? So our ML services is accurately classifying that ticket into a different one of the labels from the different set of labels that are defined by our customers. So here the query is about the what is the price. So we have labeled that ticket as a billing type of ticket. And that, so our customers defines that if that ticket is a billing, then route that issue to that particular agent handling the billing tickets. So one more example that I can give is FAQ suggestions. So even before users files any ticket, we try to find some appropriate FAQs or already smart answers written by our customers, and we suggest them to end user. And for that service is fully powered by the machine learning. So here the question is, when will my order be delivered? Right now, this ticket is not submitted. Even before submitting, we are giving some FAQ suggestions. And if a user is satisfied, that that ticket is deflected. OK. So I'll talk about what is the general workflow of machine learning models. So generally, it can be divided into two parts. one we can say it is offline, and other one we can say it is online. In offline part, you basically train the models. To train the models, you fetch the data, and after training or at the part of training only, you evaluate the models. So evaluation is done by different algorithms, and each algorithm can be run with different hyperparameters, and at the end you decide out of 10 models this model is giving best performance, and you choose it for the final deployment. So this we can say it is offline part, and in online part you use that deployed model to serve the incoming request in production. Okay, so let's say now we want to build the platform. What will be the simple architecture for it? The simple architecture will be just build models and push it into some database. Database could be anything that that you use, NoSQL, SQL, depending on your model size. And in online way, you just use those models to predict the incoming request. So this will be the simplest architecture of machine learning. So now if you want to build a very complex and support your platform to build models in real time, what will be the complexities come into picture? And what you have to think about it, and how you can solve those while building the platform? OK, so I'll go through the challenges in building a platform. Before that, I want to tell you why we chose Python to build a platform. In Helpshift, the main programming language is Clojure. So our whole backend is written in Clojure. And even I was like a main programmer at Helpshift in a data plat team. So I was very fascinated using Clojure for ML platform also. But when we started in 2006, we evaluated different programming languages to build a platform. And the clear winner was the Python. And the reason for it was the most popular data science and machine learning libraries are available in Python only. And to give you examples, normal NumPy, SciPy, Pandas, scikit-learn, are available in Python. Also, for deep learning training and model building, you have only one place to go, and that is Python. There were other reasons as well, like we wanted one language or same language for data scientists to build the models or write the algorithms and to productionize them into real time as well. Also, few of our software engineers who were actively building the platform were already software engineers writing the backend system, and they want to get started with understanding the algorithms, and having one language was a really beneficial thing for us. Okay, so let's start with the main components. I already explained you the simple architecture. One part was offline. Now let's, if you want to make it online, then what you have to do is you will be getting a request to build different kinds of models depending on what service is powered by the machine learning. And you want to build those models and push it into production. So clearly the offline part is also now online. You want to build models on demand. And now you have to think about how you will store all those models in a database, because now it's not just one model or two models. There are large number of models. And you have to also start thinking about how you will update all those models in a prediction service which are serving the incoming request. And while doing all that, you have to monitor all these components as well. How your machine learning model building services are doing, how much time they are taking, plus if you are retraining a particular model or updating a model using some feedback from the agent, then you have to make sure that your model is performing day by day because you are training it training out on more data and your goal is to improve day by day. So you have to clearly capture all these metrics and monitor them. Okay, so what are the main challenges in distributing model building tasks? So you will be getting requests to build a models with a different different goal in a building a model. So you want to distribute those tasks with a on a workers that are available with you. Some of the workers might have good resources, some might have less resources. So if one model building task needs 10 GB of RAM, then you have to intelligently route that request to that node so that it is capable to build a model. Also, you want to prioritize the task. Right now, let's say you get a 10 request to build a model, you have only 5 workers to build those models. You want to prioritize that here. This task has to be happened first, and then others can be built. You also have to make sure that you are retrying the failed task and then taking care of that. And also, all this has to be monitored. OK, so we were evaluating different frameworks in a Python, and the clear winner to use was the Celery. Many of you might be already knowing the Celery and using it to distribute the task. But we thought, let's give a try to route model building task as well, because all our requirements were satisfied by the Celery. So this is our architecture diagram that how we are using. Helpshift platform and our data scientists and software engineers can submit the model building task to Celery. And in Celery, we have defined the queues according to our model building task. So generally, a particular task is defined to a particular queue only, and it gets tasks from that queue. And there are many workers that are registered to queues, and they get they fetch the task from the Celery and builds the model. Also, we store the results metadata of results in results store. So this is a high level overview of how we are using Celery to distribute the task to our model building worker. Some of the other advantages that we got while using Celery was we could use Celery queue as per the task. The result store was available using Celery. Task could be retried, and our Celery worker could also be the one of the client node in distributed computation framework. Like if we want to build a model on using Spark or some on big data platform, then our one of the Celery worker could just be a client node and submit the task on Spark to build that model. And then once the model is built, then the worker can take over it. OK, so let's say your worker has built a model. Now you want to store it in some database. And we were checking which database can work with us and comparing different databases. And these were the main requirements or challenges. We wanted, as we in a Helpshift, we had AWS and Azure infrastructure. We wanted easy integration with the cloud providers. So let's say if we started to integrating Google platform, then we wanted seamless integration to be happened with that cloud provider as well.
we wanted model management with a versioning support. And we also wanted that our model store would be different than the model metadata that we are going to store. So what we did is we built one library that is a SpongeBob library that is completely written in a Python. And it is basically the wrapper over the S3 and WOBS. WOBS is Azure's blob storage. So S3 and WOBS on a S3 and WOBS client libraries. So this library gives you the very abstract level of operation that you can do with models. So you can just say that you can do all kinds of CRUD operation on a model, like get this model, or put the model, or delete this model that is stored on the blob storage. And the main intention was to building this library was to give you a very abstract APIs to do CRUD operations on a model. And we are using the management of a model in this cloud path. We generally give cloud storage base path. Then we give model identifier, what kind of model it is. Then do model version, and then actually place the model after it. So this is actually the path in our cloud storage to store the models. And we have also open sourced this library. You can take a look at in our Helpshift GitHub repo. And maybe if you like it, start using it for your own purpose. So this library can be used to integrate in your backend system as well, not just to use for building a machine learning platform. So once the model is pushed on the cloud storage, now you want to serve this model for predictions. So our model size was ranging from 1 MB to 25 MB. Some of our latest models are which are deep learning based, has very large size, around 1 GB as well. But right now, our model size is 1 MB to 25 MB. And we want to give these models to the prediction service when prediction service is deploying in the production. Also, we want, let's say, using some update data or feedback data, we want to retrain the particular model, and now new model is pushed into cloud storage. We immediately wanted that model to be pushed to the prediction service as well, so that it is ready to do prediction using latest model. So a simple solution for it was just write one pull service, and we completely return that service in Python. So this pull service, we named it as a sync service, which was like syncing the latest model from the cloud whenever the new model is updated. And this sync service was taking care of, this sync service is residing on the same prediction service, and it knows what kind of model is required to serve the prediction requests. So it always watches on the model in a cloud and takes care of pulling any updation on model happens. Yeah, and the model store on prediction service are on a local path only. So you basically do not need to do any network query to get the model. Models are always stored on the local path. So one more advantage of using models stored on a local path was our prediction service, where response time of prediction service was within a 10 milliseconds, because always model was stored in a OS cache, and you do not need to get from the file as well. Yeah, once we are doing prediction, model building, also pushing the models, we wanted to do monitoring on all these tasks. And the challenges in that were we already made a choice to use the celery, but salary was not giving metrics according to the time that are being used by the model. So model first goes to the wait queue in a salary, and then it is routed to the one of the queue that is defined for that task. So we want to like monitor that particular task, how much time that particular task is taking in each phase. In wait queue, in a task queue, and then how much time it is taking to actually build the model. So we wanted to monitor all that times and take action on it. And actions were simple alerting logic. If task crosses threshold time, it will alert the developers that this task is taking more than actual time and we need to debug that issue. For monitoring, what we did is we changed the metadata of job that are submitted by different source framework. And in metadata, we stored what is the start time of a submitted task. And whenever any worker faced the task, it also modifies the metadata and stores the when it took the task to build the model. So our monitoring service will read all that metadata and check how much time it is taking in each phase. And all this, we also collected other metrics from the salary worker and the salary backend. And using that, we were able to do monitoring. Other monitoring that we are doing is on a model performance. So generally, all our models are updated daily on feedback data, and we want that model is performing better day by day. So we are pushing all those metrics in graphite and doing offline monitoring on it. Yeah. So a summary of this talk could be like you can use a Python to build end-to-end platform. You can use salary to distribute model building tasks. You can build the model store on a cloud storage. And you have to write some custom service to monitor and pull models on prediction service. So to give you an idea, with this platform, our thousands of models are real time. In a production, thousands of models built in a production also are getting updated and also served to the prediction service. Yeah, any questions?
Hi. Hello. It was a really informative talk. So my question that I have for you, that how you facilitate the improvement and modification of the ML model you deploy from that client feedback and all you are receiving?
Sorry, I'm not able to hear you. Can you come this side?
Yep. Actually, the models need to be improved based upon the performance and metrics and all, right?
Right, right.
So you have one interface by which you collect it from that, that help screen that you are giving,
right.
That whether this is, or else it will be from the metrics. So right. Is it happening, how it is facilitated in this architecture?
Okay. Okay. So that's a good question. So right now question is how you are making sure the model performance happening correctly using this platform. So right now we are just pushing the model performance metric to graphite, and we are not actively checking that in online fashion. We just do the offline monitoring of those tasks and take action on it. So it's not a real-time thing right now. Yes. 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 Yeah.
I think we have time for maybe one more question.
Hi, Shyam. I'm here. So when you're building any ML algorithm and let's say it's not performing well, and then how you kind of improve that algorithm, and what kind of testing you do, like what kind of data you run on that algorithm that you know that your ML algorithm has improved. So is it a automated testing that you do, or like is it manual testing? What kind of testing you do to check whether your algorithm has improved or not?
I think your question is same as the question.
It is related to that. Yeah.
Okay. So right now we are pushing the model performance metrics on a graphite, and we are not directly using it while building a model. Let's say we have some metrics or some benchmark numbers, and when next time model is building, we do not compare the metrics that were before and the now when we have new data. So right now we are just pushing those metrics, and we have seen that almost 99% times, or almost every time, our model is performing better. So we are not doing online measurement on that task or taking action on it. We are just doing offline processes.
Does the size of training data increases whenever you improve the algorithm, or it remains the same? Like
yes, so training data increases if we are retraining that model. If we are updating that model, we just take care of feedback data that we have captured from our system.
Okay, thank you.
That's possible, but that's not a requirement. I have seen that if you are pushing some model metrics, model performance metrics, you don't want that input to the next time when model is building. What you want is a data that on which you want to build a model. So as long as you have data and you are making sure your algorithms are eventually making the model better, then you don't need to worry about that connection.